Light, 101.7 WDSR, back for another week, alongside Louis Schaefer. As always, I'm Tim Hoffmeister. We have not been traded yet, but many, many people will be, and we'll get to that later. First, we're going to start off with the NFL like we always do, because as a 12-month-a-year sport, I don't know how they do it, but they suck everyone in, and they're going to and we're going to talk about them. I believe franchise tags are right around the corner.
Yeah, should be soon.
Yeah, so, I didn't have your mic on.
Way to mute me, Tim.
Dude, I messed up, man. I messed up. Oh, Jesus. It's just something about being live, because I know we put it on air. I don't know. I was like, wow, Lewis doesn't sound like he's talking. And then I realized, I thought I had it on, though. I don't know. So, alongside Lewis Schaefer, I'm Tim Hoffmeister. We're not getting traded. Lewis had a comment, but of course you guys missed it, because I'm just a mess. I'm just terrible at this. Lewis is going to take my job. I'm getting demoted.
I couldn't figure out this board, so you're safe. You have job security.
I can still do the board. I just can't sit in a seat. The seat has too much going on, too much power. And
too close to the camera.
Yeah. I had to wash my face today. I had to clean up my beard. It was a lot of pressure. I'm sweating, and now I'm close to the camera, so it's bad. So we'll start off with the NFL offseason. Obviously, this happened last week, I believe, like Super Bowl day, I think, that Marshawn Lynch retired.
I think he tweeted that picture during the Super Bowl.
I mean, that's one way to
take it. In very Marshawn Lynch fashion, just try to slip it in there, hope no one notices.
A lot of people noticed it, and I think that was more exciting than the Super Bowl. However, we had talked about the Super Bowl, and, I mean, like we said last week, the game was whatever. So, do you think, a couple of his teammates said they don't expect him to stay retired, and do you think it was the right move? I mean, Seattle's just thanking God right now, because now they're out of how many, $10 million?
Yeah.
And they have two running backs in Chris DeMichael, who they got back after letting go, and then Thomas Rawls, and they're both getting paid like $500K.
Yeah, I think they made out good.
They really did, and I think both those players are more versatile than Marshawn Lynch.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, Michael kind of fits more like Marshawn Lynch's mold, but it seems as though, I mean, not that Thomas Rawls is Todd Gurley, but it seems that he could fit kind of that mold, just kind of do everything. He can catch the ball out of the backfield, which is something Marshawn struggled with. You know, and he's big bodied, so he could easily replace him. I think that's what it came down to. I think they didn't want to pay $10 million a year anymore. We're ready to cut him to just say we're rolling with Thomas Rawls, and I think he wanted to get ahead of them before.
So it was almost like a pride thing instead of like,
well, I mean, I think you see how a lot of the running backs go out now. I mean, Steven Jackson came on week 15 with the Patriots because he was sitting out there. I do. I think it's a pride thing. I think he didn't want to sit out there as a, 29, 30-year-old free agent running back, when 30's usually that magic number where teams are like, yeah, you're going downhill now.
Yeah, I mean, I never looked at it that way. I mean, it makes sense because, I mean, the Seahawks looked much, much more prolific on offense with Lynch out.
Yeah. I mean, I think it came with just the fact that Rawls can do more, like I said. He can catch the ball in the backfield, etc. I'm really interested to see. I don't think they played at the same time, because I think Lynch was still healthy then. But when they get Graham back, that's what I'm interested to see. That if Rawls plays the way he did this year, that could be something special on offense.
Yeah, I mean, and we were expecting it last year, and maybe it was Lynch that was holding them up. He was just giving them, because it seemed like when Russell Wilson was getting out of the pocket, him and Cam Newton this year, it just seemed when they got out of the pocket and were able to step into a throw, it was money every time.
Yeah, and I think it's an ego thing, too. I mean, you got to give Marshawn Lynch the ball or else. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's quiet now because he gets the ball, but what if he doesn't? So
True. And then maybe that stopped Russell Wilson from getting into a
rhythm. Yeah.
Another guy, before we get on the franchise tags, I know I haven't even looked at the free agents list, but I know Arian Foster's a big guy that's possibly getting cut. And, like Lynch, he's I think he's over 30.
I think so.
He was a late bloomer in the league. I think he went undrafted out of Tennessee. But Thomas Rawls, more versatile, makes sense why they're leaning more towards him, and he's cheaper. Do you think Foster, when he gets cut, that he should probably stick around? I know he's at injury troubles, but he is more versatile. He's been known to be a threat out of the backfield. I think that's the main reason why he originally got the starting running back job with the Texans.
Yeah. I think he will stick around, because Marshawn Lynch is a better running back, but teams see value in the fact that, you know, if you could do more, you know, there's thought that, say, Matt Forte may look to New England because they can get him to the playoffs, he can catch the ball. He's one of those running backs, he can do everything. And, they have Deion Lewis and Garrett Blunt, but it's a lot better for your offense if you have a guy that can do both, because you don't know then what's going to, with the Pats this year, kind of seemed like, okay, if Lewis is in, it's either getting, run to the outside or screen pass, some sort of thing. He's not going up the middle. And if Blunt was in, if they were running it, they were going up the middle. I think, with Foster's versatility, I think he'll find somewhere to play. Maybe Chicago, with them, saying, goodbye to Forte, go find somewhere else to play. I think that could be an option. 1-2 year deal. He's not going to cost much because he hasn't stayed healthy in 2 years. So I could see that being an option for him. I think he'll find a team.
Yeah, I think he'll find a team too. Probably he might have to take a lesser role because it seems like when he's getting the bigger role, he's not staying healthy. And I mean, obviously they don't want to pay Forte the money in Chicago, and it's interesting when you look at it because you think, well, why would they bring in Foster when he's an older version of Matt Forte?
Yeah.
Well, the thing is, he's going to be much cheaper, like you said, than Matt Forte. And at the same time, Langford is kind of a guy they've tried to turn into the type of Matt Forte player, and he's shown that he could do it out of the backfield. He could run the ball. And you bring in Foster, who's an older guy, and you give more load to Langford, and then you have kind of a third down back, a guy that's can almost like mentor him, because I think Foster's probably one of the best pass-catching running backs next to Matt Forte in our generation.
Yeah, Matt Forte, Foster, Reggie Bush,
until that Sheldon Brown hit, and that really ended up. But let's get to talking about franchise tag. There's some big names out there. Huge year for free agency, and I'm sure it'll dwindle down by the time the franchise tag season is over. There's three names that are out there. Maybe you could probably even say four that are big candidates for the franchise tag. I mean, you have Von Miller, who's looking to get paid after basically winning the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
Josh Norman, who had a breakout year this year. He's ready to cash in. And then you have Kirk Cousins and Alshon Jeffrey.
Yeah.
I mean, there's other names on there. You have Muhammad Wilkerson. I think he kind of had a down year just because the D-line was stacked. You heard about him less.
Yeah.
Other than that, I think those are probably the biggest names. If you're an Eagles fan, you can throw Sam Bradford in there, but I'm just going to cross my fingers and say no, he doesn't get it. But out of those five guys you want to count, Wilkerson, who do you think are the most likely to get the franchise tag?
Well, I think definitely Von Miller. Supposedly these reports that if Peyton Manning comes back, it's not with the Broncos that they're going to get rid of him. I mean, that's just clear as a bell to me then that we need the money to sign Von Miller, whether it's through an extension or through the franchise tag. I think he'll get tagged. I think they'll tag him and they'll work on a deal, because they can they can replace Brandon Marshall, they can replace Danny Trevathan, they can replace Malik Jackson. You're not going to replace the best pass rusher in the league behind J.J. Watt. So,
I was thinking probably they should franchise tag him because I don't think they're going to be able to work out a long-term deal at this point. However, you look at what they have. I have the franchise tags number here. It's just over $14 million for a linebacker. And they still have Ware. They're possibly going to cut him. They got to pay their corners eventually. You think that the best option is to work out a long-term deal with him, and then you might be able to keep Ware because I don't know how much Osweiler is going to cost.
Yeah.
And maybe you franchise Osweiler. I know it would be $19 million for the quarterback. Yeah. But maybe you franchise him because you're not really sure
what he is yet.
Yeah, yeah.
You got it, like, you can't give Osweiler, like, giving him maybe 3 years at 15 mil, like, you don't know if he's ever going to be worth that. I mean, instead of 1 year at 19 mil, he might show you something. So, it's going to be hard because if you franchise tag Von Miller, you're either putting all your eggs in Osweiler's going to be good, or you're just saying we don't need a good quarterback to win. I mean, you had Peyton Manning this year, but I mean, if you're going to need money, you're going to have to probably cut Ware.
Yeah.
You're going to see guys start falling off that defense.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I see where you're coming from, but I don't think there's a way that they get rid of Von Miller. Unless
I don't think so at all. I'm just saying, do you think, like, what do you, like, I was trying to look at what's best for them so, right now.
Yeah.
But is a long-term deal kind of rushing it now? I mean, if you're Von Miller, you might just take the tag at this point because it's going to be more than you get paid.
Yeah.
I mean, he'll probably get paid $10 mil a year.
Yeah,
I don't see him getting paid more than the franchise tag annually at 14 mil.
Yeah,
I'd say the highest maybe 12 million.
12 mil, 13 mil. He ain't going to touch 14, no. Yeah, I mean, I think he'll get a long-term deal done. But, I mean, the problem is when you win the Super Bowl, the time frame's so short. I mean, the Super Bowl was, what, the 7th? Yeah. So, I mean, that's 31 days before the league year starts. So, I don't see it happening. I don't see it a situation in which they could have gotten anything done in such a short period of time when he knows he can cash in. So, yeah, I think the players kind of get their eyes on, I'm going to make a crap load of money, as a free agent. Oh man, they slapped a tag on me. Yeah, while 14 mil is still a good payday, kind of brings them down a notch if they need to start looking at an extension. Like, okay, I'm locked in here. I actually like it here. Like, let's work on the deal.
Yeah, I think that's going to be a very interesting thing to look at when you have, you got Von Miller and just basically a backup quarterback. I know Osweiler started some this year, but, I mean, it's going to be which one of those guys gets the tag because, like I said, are they ready to commit to Osweiler long term, and have they seen enough? So, Von Miller, he'll stay. It's just to see what he'll get. And depending on how they feel about Osweiler will depend, I think, will play a part in what Von Miller gets. Another guy, Josh Norman, as we mentioned, breakout year this year. I believe they're calling it Lake Norman is his nickname because it's not Revis Island. I heard that a couple times on Super Bowl coverage, so I guess he's going with that, but, obviously, a huge year for him.
Yeah. Out of nowhere.
Do you think, and the tag's $13.8 million for a corner, if you're the Carolina Panthers, are you tagging him just because you're worried about it? He's a one-year wonder? Or have you seen enough to buy in?
I would say they tag him. I mean, like I said, it's not like this. He's been doing this for 2-3 seasons. This was the first season that he's really been good. So, I think it's in Carolina's best interest to slap a tag on him and see. And you wonder something? If he... that's a chance you take. But I would say he gets tagged, plays out the year, leaves. Because I think if he cashes in, if he plays well again, he's going to cash in. They can't tag him a second year. And he's going to walk because players don't like getting tagged because they're on a one-year deal. If they get hurt, there goes all the money they had built up.
Jason Pierre-Paul.
Look back to Drew Brees. That was when he what was it, his shoulder with the Chargers, mm-hmm. when they had him on the tag. Ever since then, players don't like getting tagged. I mean, Julius Peppers stands out when the Panthers tagged him, and the next year he walked to the Bears. So, I don't know. I think players don't like getting tagged. I think Norman will get tagged because he was good this year. They can't afford to lose him because then who are you playing? Ben Wickery?
I mean, that's. Yeah, Courtland Finnegan, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah. He'll come out of retirement again week 9. But I just don't see a way in which. I mean, they're going to tag him. I think he walks after next season. But they'll definitely tag him to see if last year was, a one-time deal or if it was more this is Josh Norman. This is, you know, it just took a while to get here.
Yeah, how about Kirk Cousins? Kind of like Josh Norman. I mean, he's always been there.
Yeah.
It's just finally he broke out.
Yeah. I don't think Kirk Cousins gets tagged. I don't think he will. I mean, the chance the Redskins take is that the quarterback class is deep. And they made the playoffs, so it's not like they have this great pick where they could get a Paxton Lynch or something if all fell to hell. But, I mean, quarterbacks don't change that often. Washington gave him a chance. I mean, I think there's ties there. I don't think they need to tag him because I think he'll come back. He fits that offense. I mean, he's Andy Dalton. He fits what Gruden's trying to do. And then they'll have the money. They have the money as it is right now. Plus, I heard they're looking to cut Deshaun. So, I mean,
surprise.
Yeah. So, I mean, do you worry about, you know, L.A. or hell? You guys are in the division. Why not make Washington weaker? Philly making a run at them? Sure. But, I mean, the Reds, from a Redskins standpoint, they gave them a chance. There's going to be ties to the Redskins. And I think he'll come back regardless. I don't think there's a need to tag him, especially for probably, what is it, 19 mil or something like that for quarterback?
Yeah, I think it's a little over. 19.7 mil.
Yeah, he's not worth that at all. I mean, he'll sign maybe a 4 or 5 year deal, 7 mil, 8 mil a year. I mean, he's not going to get much more than that. He showed flashes when he'd come in to replace RG3 when he was injured. But last year was his first time starting for a whole season, and he played well. So, I don't think he's not worth 19 mil.
I think he'll get 15, though. I think it's a big possibility.
See, if he hits the market, he could, just because teams would be jacking the price up on him. But,
I feel like if Washington wants to sign him to a long-term deal, it's going to take 15 mil. I mean, look at some of the that's just how the quarterbacks are working now. Like, if you think you might have your guy, you're locking him up. Tannehill, 15 mil. Cutler, 17 mil.
I mean, Tannehill was a first-round pick. They went out of their way to trade for Cutler. So, I mean, they kind of walked backwards into Kirk Cousins. It was like, oh, well, RG3 hasn't done anything in the 3 years we've had him. Let's see what Cousins can do.
Yeah, but, I mean, he knows his market. So, if you're saying,
yeah,
hey, I'll give you 10 mil, he's saying, I'll just get some here.
Yeah,
and then they're going to have to franchise tag. So I think they'll back themselves at a corner. I think they'll get, like, I think 15 mil might be pretty good for Cousins. 3 year deal, maybe with like an option.
Yeah.
But I think I think if he hits the market, he could get close to 20 mil. I mean, there's talk about Sam Bradford maybe getting 25. Like seriously.
Who would do that? Who in their right mind would do that?
Well, Houston's trying to contend with no quarterback, so I don't know.
They can sit back and get Hackenberg.
I mean, I guess it's, you need a quarterback to win.
Yeah, you need a quarterback to compete.
And I just feel like that's just, I mean, Washington and Kirk Cousins aren't close to a deal reportedly, but I just feel like that's what they have to pay the guy.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know what the guaranteed money, if you have to make it more average annual value with less guaranteed money, because we all know the guaranteed money makes the deal.
No guaranteed money is the
deal,
yeah.
If you give the guy a 4 year deal and make it $50 million guaranteed, that's a pretty hefty deal that you're going to have to try and wiggle your way out of. But I mean, if you get 25 guaranteed, I mean, you can get out of that after 2 years.
Yeah.
Maybe even 1 year after that. So, I think maybe Washington's like, hey, like, we'll give you 15 mil a year, we'll give you 30 guaranteed, and he's like, well, no, because then I'm done. Like, 30 guaranteed is really nothing.
Yeah.
Which is kind of crazy. I would take $3 guaranteed, but, yeah, I feel like if Washington wants to keep him, and I think they do, like, because like you said, he fits Gruden's style, they're going to have to give him a 3 or 4 year deal. I mean, he's only 27, I think.
Yeah.
So, I mean,
I think the problem is Washington's kind of painting themselves in a corner here. I mean, it's no secret they're going to cut RG3 when the league year starts. You know, Colt McCoy is not a starting quarterback. So it's not like, if RG3 was just hurt, if let's say last year was the first time ever he blew out his knee in camp, And I was like, okay, Kirk, it's your job for the year. You know, then if he played the way he did and Washington was saying, okay, maybe we can go with Kirk Cousins and see what we can get for RG3, you know, then you're looking at a spot where, oh, you want this much money? Go somewhere else and get it, because we got RG3. And the problem is that RG3's proven to be bad and can't stay healthy, so they have no other option to turn to where they could confidently say, oh, well, if you don't want to play here, go play in L.A., go play in Cleveland. You know, have fun.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you there. They're hamstrung. They really are. I mean, if you somehow maybe have your guy, you're locked in if you're a team at this point.
Yeah.
And whereas it seems like quarterback is that only position, but then you have Alshon Jeffrey, one of the best receivers in the league, and there's talk of him getting franchise tagged, maybe even them letting him walk.
Yeah, I don't think he's going to get tagged. I think he's going to be on a different team.
Which is crazy. I mean, he's very young. I don't know his age, but I know he's probably not even 30 yet, right? He's only 26 years old.
Yeah.
One of the best young receivers in the league, and it would only be $14 million to franchise tag him. Do you think he could get way above $14 million? Do you think that's what he's looking for?
I think he could. I think he definitely could. I mean, he's 26 years old. I mean, can still improve in the right system. He's had good numbers with Jay Cutler. So, I mean, even a team like Detroit, and Matt Stafford's not the best quarterback in the world by any means, but you just lost Calvin Johnson. Maybe we throw some money at Alshon Jeffrey.
Well, Calvin Johnson's making what, $25 million?
Yeah.
So, I mean, listen, if Calvin's actually retiring, you just freed up $25 million.
Yeah.
Throw it towards a 26-year-old kid at that point.
Yeah. With, like I said, room to improve. I mean, that's just... people don't like Jay Cutler.
Which is... I mean, listen, I'm not protecting Jay Cutler. Like, he's had his ups and downs.
Yeah.
He doesn't seem like he wants to be out there at all.
No.
However, if you're a Chicagoan, I guess that's what they're called, Chicagoite.
Chicagoite.
If you're from Chicago, like, it seems like you probably don't like Jay Cutler. However, if they let Alshon Jeffrey walk, you gotta kind of like look at the front office a little and be like, listen, like we understand Jay Cutler's not the greatest quarterback.
Yeah.
But if you're getting rid of Alshon Jeffrey, they had Brandon Marshall at one point. Zach Miller became his top receiver.
Yeah.
Like, you're not giving him anything. So at the same time, you want to blame Jay Cutler. Excuse me, I'm getting all flustered about Jay Cutler. You gotta look at
the He doesn't even get this flustered.
Yeah. You gotta look at the front office and be like, really, man? Like,
yeah.
Like, Brandon Marshall, I get it. He was getting up there in age. Getting up there in age, I mean, like, late 20s.
Yeah.
Because for some reason, just in the NFL, if you hit 30, you're declining unless you're a quarterback.
Yeah.
So, and that made sense. They drafted Jeffrey, I believe, that year when they let Marshall go.
White. They drafted White.
Oh, sorry, yeah. Marshall wasn't on...
They drafted Marshall. They traded Marshall this year to the Jets.
Oh, okay, yeah, that's right. So, they had Marshall, and then they got Jeffrey, and they realized Jeffrey was ready to take the next step.
Yeah.
Got rid of Marshall. They got Kevin White. That didn't work out, but still, like... I mean, just give Jeffrey 1 year when White comes and plays. Maybe then White can take the next step. But, like, I just don't see getting rid of the 26-year-old receiver at this point, especially when that division was much more wide open than anyone was expecting this year.
Yeah.
I mean, would they finish 6-10?
Something like that, yeah.
And I think they beat Green Bay once.
Yeah.
And Green Bay didn't finish too great. I mean, they were kind of struggling towards the end of the year. So, I mean, it doesn't take that much to contend in the NFL. They're not that far away. I mean, the defense, I mean, much better than anyone expected.
Yeah.
Langford was awesome last year. And, I mean, if you can't give away your top receiver at that point.
Yeah, I mean...
That division's one of the most open in the NFL. I mean, other than the NFC East and the AFC South. That's the next best division to make a move.
Yeah. I don't know. I think their front office kind of sees it from, you know, the moves they've made in the past couple of seasons. It seems like they're more worried about protecting Jay Cutler up front, because that used to be a huge problem, and not as much anymore. Yeah, we've had guys come on that were bad with other teams, become good in Chicago. One that sticks out my mind is Vlad Dukas, came over from the Vikings, originally with the Jets. I only remember him because my brother loves him, because they call him Big Ugly on the Jets. they draft Kyle Long. Hironas Grasu out of Oregon played better towards the end of his rookie year this year. They've built around protecting Jay Cutler, and then obviously they have to pick Jay Cutler. They've built the team otherwise around protecting him, and then hoping we don't give up points when he screws up, because it seems like that happens way too often. And they're just like, okay, defense, he screwed up again, go stop him. You know, and they have guys that fit their defensive scheme. I'm interested more to see what John Fox does now in his second year there. I think he's going to have a lot of pull to bring in players. I think they more worry about just trying to stop the other offense when Jay Cutler makes boneheaded decisions, because he's Jay Cutler. So,
but you think they're going to be able to do that in free agency?
It'll be interesting. I mean, I don't put it past him to make a run at a guy like, you know, Vernon, Malik Jackson. Weddle has already said he's leaving San Diego. So I don't put it past them to make him run for some of these big defensive guys and try to, you know. They've been that way for years. I mean, they go pursue Peppers when they have literally nothing else on defense and land Julius Peppers. It was him and Urlacher for how many years.
Yeah, I just feel like that if you got... I don't think Jay Cutler's a terrible quarterback. I feel like if you got an above-average quarterback...
Well, you also brought him to Sam Bradford.
Well, I had to. That was my duty as a Philadelphia fan. But, I mean, Jay Cutler is better than Sam Bradford. And I think if you have a big-time receiver who's only 26...
Yeah.
I feel like you... Listen, at that point... You got two good linemen. I don't care what else you got on the line, because you only need 2.5 seconds for Alshon Jeffery to box out that corner.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know. It doesn't really, because looking at the linemen, they didn't really do anything for me. You're gonna pay $7 million for Jahari Evans, who got bought out in his second year of his contract.
Yeah.
The Eagles will, because he's just from the area. I think he went to Bloomsburg.
Yeah.
Just they'll do it because they like to annoy me. But, like, I mean, guys like Steve Wisniewski, he's a center. He can play guard.
Yeah.
But, I mean, do you really want to change his position? He's going to be a good amount of money. I mean, he's only 26.
Yeah. I mean, the problem is that with the tag is you can't get them again. So I think that's the big thing. And, you know, Team C, I don't even know how tall he is. I know he's big. But I want to say he's like 6'3", 6'4", maybe?
He's 6'4", 230.
6'4", I mean, yeah, that's huge for a receiver. I mean, I think Calvin ran 6'5", so I mean, that's... I mean... With these upper echelon players, you know, Von Miller, Alshon Jeffery, Josh Norman, Wilkerson, Vernon, Eric Berry, he'll probably get tagged so they can't work a deal out. You know, with these, you're kind of playing a tough game, because it's, you know, yeah, we can tag them, and if we tag them, we piss them off, because they don't want to be tagged. Granted, it's our right to tag them, we're allowed to do it once per year, but then you can't get them a second year, now you've angered them, and you have no shot of getting them back.
I think you gotta work out a long-term deal with them.
But I think he's more... I think the issue with a receiver is that teams are willing to look past the numbers. Because he's 6'4", he can go up and get the ball. I think a lot of GMs now realize, listen, we get it, Jay Cutler. You know, if you put him with Tom Brady, he's going to end up, you know, top 3 in yards and touchdowns.
He averaged a career high in yards per game this year. With injury issues, with Jay Cutler.
Marshall wasn't there.
I mean, well, yeah, because he's the number one guy. I don't know. That's I feel like if you got a big receiver, you got to keep him. Only 26. I just feel like it's just stupid to let him go.
Yeah, but the problem is like I said, if you tag him, he's not going to want to come back because now you've put the potential on where if he gets hurt again, now he got hurt last year, if he gets hurt next year, it's going to knock his value. Now, granted, you're
allowed... sign him for cheaper.
Yeah.
if he leaves, I'm going to hit up Obama and we're going to riot in Chicago. He's a big Chicago... I mean, he's from Chicago, so... we'll take a break here. We'll come back. We'll talk some more off-season stuff. We'll talk about the Eagles and the Giants. The Giants just bought a couple people out.
Yeah.
I believe John Beeson just retired. I
suppose there's more on the way, too, so...
More retirees or more cuts?
Cuts.
Yeah, and the Eagles eventually will start cutting people, maybe. Might franchise tag Sam Bradford. Might bring back Nick Foles. Send in your trades to @DonHass_Hoff, @Schaefer500, @OfficialMNL, or use the hashtag Monday Night Lights, whether it's in the NFL, the MLB, the NBA, or NHL.
Yeah.
We're in two trade deadlines and two off seasons, so we're in a good time to talk about a lot of hypotheticals.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Tweet them in. I already got a couple. We'll read them when... We got one NFL on the way when we get back, and then we have an NHL one. So when we get to NHL, we'll read that. But keep sending them in. I'll leave with some you too, and we'll come back right after this break on Monday Night Lights, 101.7 WDSR.
Around. I'm getting ready to leave the ground.
101.7 WDSR, U2, City of Blinding Lights. It's a really good song. One of my mom's favorites. I had to play that for her because I forgot to call her yesterday on Valentine's Day. I felt really bad. So, everyone who listens to Monday Night Lights, I'm an a-hole. I apologize, Mom. It's probably the stupidest thing I've ever done in my life. And I've done some pretty stupid things.
Yeah.
I've done some pretty stupid things. Like, you don't even know.
You don't even know, bruh.
Alright, so let's get off that topic now, just so my parents aren't like, wait, what was it?
What do you do?
Yeah, what was it? What did you say? But, yeah, we'll talk about some free agents. We'll talk about the Eagles and the Giants, because we have an Eagles fan and a Giants fan. Also, I have this question that I want to answer, because, obviously, Peyton might be retiring.
Yeah.
Marshawn Lynch retired. And, obviously, you can see one guy who, I don't know, seems like he could be a good coach, and one that probably wouldn't be, mainly because he doesn't like other people.
Yeah.
So, what kind of players that are now or have recently retired do you think could be great coaches?
I mean, you look at Peyton Manning, that's like the example of like what you want. I mean, the way he knows how to dissect the defense, and, you know, I don't think it would be that big of a transition for him to make the jump over to being a coach. Trying to think of some other ones. I think we might see Patrick Willis eventually make the jump over. I could see him doing it. I mean, I think most of the time, I think it's, you know, your quarterbacks, your middle linebackers, your play callers, because they have to know the system, know the plays, and know where everyone has to be, and, you know, all, you know, audible and whatever. So there's a lot that goes with being a play caller. And I just, you know, those players. So Willis, Peyton, when Brady, Breeze hanging up, I could see them doing it. You know, I don't necessarily see like running backs, receivers being great coaches.
I mean, you have the position coaches, but at the same like Deuce Staley, like his running back coach, like what does he really do?
Yeah.
I mean, there's only so much you can coach an NFL player.
Yeah.
Like, oh, like do a zone read. Like, you don't have to show a guy how to accept a handoff on a zone read.
No.
Like high school, I had to learn how to take a zone read handoff. But most NFL guys, I mean, you go through the system.
Yeah.
You probably have done a zone read handoff at one point. But yeah, I looked at it because of Peyton Manning. You look at Peyton Manning and they're making the calls, making the audibles at the line. You're thinking, well, he can read a defense. Why can't he make a game plan?
Yeah.
And do it that way. And at the same time, I looked at it and said, well, how frustrating is that to know that the guy that's calling the plays, audibling, and running your plays probably isn't going to do as good of a job as you?
Yeah, yeah.
Because think about it. How many Hall of Fame players become Hall of Fame coaches?
Not many.
It was always the saying, bad player, good coach.
Yeah.
Which was my saving grace growing up. Yeah, my saving grace growing up, because I'm just like, all right, well, I'm not a good player. Let me just learn what I can.
Yeah.
And, I mean, it helped me learn, but I don't know if it's going to make me a good coach. I don't know if it makes me good at talking on the air about it. But that's what people say, because you have a lot of time to watch, learn, not play, basically.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think that's why we see a lot of backup quarterbacks now. I mean, I think Sean Payton was.
Yeah.
Jim Harbaugh was. I'm not sure if John was.
I don't know what John did.
Yeah, I don't know. I know he was a special teams guy with you, but...
Yeah, and we let him go.
Yeah.
We got Doug Peterson.
Like I said, Doug Peterson's back. Yeah, I think that's the thing. I think that might be the secret is, you know, when you sit on the sideline with a clipboard right next to the head coach, I think you learn a thing or two.
Yeah, it doesn't say. He went to Miami of Ohio. He might have just, like, went straight into coaching. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe.
He worked at his assistant. He was an Eagles assistant. Yeah, I'm not sure if he ever played, and it doesn't say. Huh. So John just did not play. Unless, I mean, Miami of Ohio, I don't know. No, I don't see anything, so.
Yeah, no.
You don't even have to play to be. I mean, I'm sure he played, obviously, in like high school or whatever.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean. Could we look at, like, Curtis Painter being, like, the next great coach? Or, I mean, like, career backups? I mean, I don't know. It's, I guess you need, I have to want to do it.
Yeah.
Like, looking at some of the backup quarterbacks now, like, who do you think could do it? Just, like, hypothetically, I mean, Redskins, they have, what, Colt McCoy?
Yeah.
You have Eagles, Sanchez. You have Giants, Nassib, and you have the Cowboys. I guess it's Kellen Moore now.
Yeah. Johnny Manziel.
Yeah. So, I mean, you look at that. I mean, I don't know. Maybe it's hard for people to picture Doug Peterson.
Yeah.
But, I don't know. And then the backup for the Vikings, is it Ponder? No.
What, with the Vikings?
No, they got rid of Ponder.
No, Sean Hill could.
I can see that. And you have, what, Hundley with the Packers.
Yeah.
You know who I can see, who I'm looking at the backups now? I'm going to skip ahead. Drew Stanton.
Yeah.
Of the Cardinals. I mean, when he went in there for Palmer last year, before he got hurt, I mean, and then...
Well, he was kind of already in a coaching role this year.
Yeah.
Because they would dress Barkley.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And he just kind of has that, like, when, who was it got the, like, I guess was it Fitzgerald, and he was waving him?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Like, he just kind of got that, like, that
the energy,
that you kind of see, that, like, Harbaugh had, that Pete Carroll has.
Yeah.
I could really rally guys around him.
Yeah.
So, I actually...
Matt
Hasselbeck can do anything. He is God incarnate.
Joe's trying to call in right now and is going to find out the phone doesn't work.
I should have said that. The phone's down, so if you're trying to call in, we apologize. Use Twitter or the Facebook group. We apologize.
Joe's just probably still angry about Matt Hasselbeck.
Yeah, he shouldn't be, man. He actually almost gave him a chance to win the division. However, yeah, I think Sean Hill, like, I didn't even think about him. And then Drew Stanton, two guys have been in the league for a while, have had starting experience, have just accumulated a lot of knowledge from different places, and are probably your best backups.
Yeah.
Some of your best backups in the league that you don't even think of. I mean, Chase Daniel. I love Chase Daniel. He might be your quarterback of the Philadelphia Eagles. We'll get to that. But I think I really like him. He's a great coach. He should be a great coach. I mean, but like, yeah, it's funny looking at how... Eventually, we'll be like, I remember watching that guy play.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not that far off, which makes me feel really old.
Yeah.
So, but that's something to think of. If you got any ideas what players...
Works like Jason Kidd being a coach now.
Exactly. Yeah. Derek Fisher. I mean, we can call it the end of his career, but still. So, if any of you guys got ideas of players, either current, former, I mean, they could be like 26 now, and if you think they'll be a great coach, whatever, in any sport... let us know. We'll keep that going. We'll keep that question in the off season. We can put it in NBA and the NHL. Maybe some basketball. Guys will become like who coaches for Duke? Who's on the bench for Duke right now? He's used to playing. He was awesome, and then whatever. But always players always do that.
Yeah.
So let's talk about needs of the Eagles Giants. Let's talk about how their off season is going so far. I feel like we can save the mock draft because April just seems so far away. But it's really not.
It's not.
The draft's, what, 2 months away? Or a little over 2 months away?
Yeah.
Is it going to be April 30th, I guess? Towards the end of April?
Yeah, it's usually towards the end of April. Normally, I'm studying for finals by the time it rolls around.
So I'm really studying for the draft and not finals?
Yeah.
I got my big board.
Don't tell my mom.
So yeah, we got the draft coming up about a little over 2 months away.
Yeah.
So we can hold off on the mock draft and... I know Giants, a couple guys cut, guy retired, a couple more you said, so
yeah,
want to talk about that a little?
Well, they're talking about cutting him if he doesn't restructure, mostly because his guaranteed money's up, so, but Victor Cruz, supposedly, they're looking at telling him to either restructure because you haven't played in 2 years, or we're going to cut you outright, and, we have Odell Beckham. So he's supposedly a potential casualty. I've read some others. I mean, they're talking Rashad Jennings could be. I'm trying to think of other ones I saw. And they already cut Colin Jenkins during the season, so that's dud. That's a dud. I mean, Cruz was the big one that I saw. You know, like I said, either to get him to restructure and knock down that money, knock down that cap number, or cut him outright and say, you know, find some other team willing to pay you that much money when you haven't played in 2 years. Good luck.
What is the cap hit of Cruz?
I believe it's, if I had to guess, I'd say it's around 12.
And what would they get? What would they get if they cut him? Like, how much relief?
I believe they get 10 back if they cut
him. That might just be better than him restructuring at that point.
Yeah.
Because I mean, he's not going to take a $10 million cut. Obviously,
no.
He would be nuts too.
No, and as it stands right now, the Giants, before any potential new recruits, have $55 million based on last year's cap. Plus, I read a report today that said when they release the cap numbers, it's going up.
It should, with the revenue.
Yeah. And then if they get that extra $10 million, I mean, I would do it. I would do it. I mean, you're looking at a spot where, I mean, you have Odell Beckham. I mean, it's a very weak receiver class. But, I mean, if we're going to cut Cruz and the Redskins are looking into Deshaun and Anquan Boldin and all these guys, you can find some guy to come in for 2 years, $7 million, $10 million a year. I mean, you know, you're spending the money in the wrong place because you don't need to pay that much for a receiver when you could bring back Ruben Randall, you have Odell Beckham. But I mean, the Giants just need to figure it out because there's a lot of holes. I mean, this is the most holes I've seen the Giants have in a while. I mean, they need to re-sign Luke Kamara. He's a free agent. Figure out the Pierre Paul situation, whether they're going to keep him, let him go, whatever. I mean, you cut Beeson.
We're already short on linebackers.
Yeah, already short on linebackers. Granted, we cut Beeson, who was old. He was a liability at this point.
He ended up retiring.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, so they got rid of him. Kennard looks good. Kennard looks like he's going to be solid. Unai Unga is a backup. He should not start. They need to get a middle linebacker. I don't care if you have to try to draw that 49er that retired after a year and back into the league. Just get someone. I don't know. I would say if they need to address linebacker. The offensive line's been built up. I would say with Hankins, Ayers, Pierre Paul, if you could sign a D tackle, maybe you make a run on Malik Jackson. Maybe I'm just shooting for the stars there, but I mean, get someone, solidify that defensive line, try to get some linebacker help in case you do decide to go with a Zeke Elliott or something on offense as opposed to a Jalen Smith, Miles Jack from UCLA. In case you decide to not go linebacker, sign some linebackers. I think that's the biggest thing they have to spend the money on, and re-sign with Kamara and Pierre Paul.
Yeah, I mean, and there's some pretty good middle linebackers, especially out there. I mean, you have...
And make a run at Eric Weddle. That's just me. I want his beard on my team.
Listen, I love Eric Weddle. He tapes his fingers.
Yeah.
I used to do that all the time in high school. He is my spirit animal. But, I mean, you look at some of the inside linebackers, Danny Trevathan. I mean, he's 25, unrestricted.
Yeah.
I mean, he's only getting paid $1,500,000. So, I mean, you look at, like, I mean, obviously he's good for a big pay cut. You can outpay the Broncos look how many guys they got to resign. Quarterback Von Miller, I mean, they're going to have to cut Ware, but still they might not even have enough money because they got to sign Jackson.
Yeah.
And then you have guys like Keenan Robinson, who had a breakout year in Washington, weakens your a division rival. And then you have Rolando McClain, who came out of nowhere with Dallas, or came back with Dallas after failing in Oakland, but that was kind of what everyone did at that time.
Yeah.
And then you have older guys, I mean, Derek Johnson, Sean Weatherspoon, but I mean, there's still a bunch of inside linebackers out there. So
yeah.
Looking at what you said, I mean, it's very possible and might seem like the smartest thing to do. And then outside linebackers, I mean, Alden Smith, you might not want to take a chance on him, but,
yeah.
But I mean, you never know. He's only 26.
Giants don't take risky moves.
Yeah, it's, but I mean, you have Courtney Upshaw from Baltimore,
yeah.
who I think has been quietly one of the best outside linebackers in the league, or best
yeah.
young outside linebackers in the league. Yeah, but I mean, I don't see, I mean, Mark Barron, ever since he changed from safety to the linebacker. But yeah, Bruce Irving, if you want to pay like $18 million. But no, I agree with you. I think that the way the free agent class lines up,
yeah.
it's almost saying, like, listen, you got to go offense.
Yeah.
And I think that's what the Giants should do. But then again, are they willing to pay out the money? Do they think they're ready to contend to pay out the money? Because you see a lot of free agent deals, they don't really work out that much.
Yeah.
I mean, Denver was kind of the exception with winning the Super Bowl. But, I mean, you look at Maxwell, Asamoah. I'm only naming Eagles because, you know, I'm just like to make the Eagles fans sad, but they just don't seem to work out as everyone plans.
Yeah, no.
So, I mean, I think they'll be cautious there, even though they have a crap ton of money. With the way the cap is being raised, probably upwards of $65 million.
Yeah.
So, but we'll switch to the Eagles right now because why not? They got a lot of big contracts that I really kind of hope are bought out. You got Jason Peters at $9 million. I definitely think they got to buy him out. Yeah, you don't got really that much of an offensive line, but at his age, the way this team's going, I think you could take that $9 million, put it elsewhere. I think Lane Johnson is ready to be that left tackle.
Yeah.
And he's only getting paid $8 million. I mean, it's only $1 million difference, but still, and he's younger. Maxwell, I think you got to keep just because who else you gonna get?
Yeah. Yeah.
You gotta give him at least another
Norman year. Ain't going anywhere. So it's,
exactly.
You're not getting anything better.
I mean, and then you're gonna be sticking if you re-sign Nolan Carroll, then you'll be stuck with Carroll and Rowe if you get rid of Maxwell. Or if you get rid of Maxwell and Carroll, you get Rowe.
Yeah.
And Jalen Watkins. So I mean, I think you guys gotta give him another year. I mean, at that point, who cares? Murray, I think you should keep. Fletcher Cox, I don't know if he even re-signed yet. I don't think he did. They have him down as a cap hit, but I don't believe he resigned yet. I know there was talk they were close or whatever, but then you have Connor Barwin, $7 million, Malcolm Jenkins, $7 million. They're two big key guys on your defense. I know
yeah.
People are saying Connor Barwin doesn't fit in a 4-3. He's just a crazy athlete.
Yeah.
I mean, he'll be able to do it, and at $7 million, I think you'd be stupid not to try.
Yeah.
And then you got Sanchez. Please cut him. Take all of his money away from him. Jason Kelce, only $5 million. Brandon Graham, I think he'll do really well in the 4-3. I think he's a really good edge rusher. D'Amico Ryans, with all the inside linebackers you have, $4.5 million. It seems pretty cheap, but it's still at the same time. It's like he is 35.
Yeah.
And then I see Sproles probably going at 4.5. They're probably cutting him. So, I mean, I like to see some of the free agents they got. Biggers, I think he played really well in the nickel last year. Then you have Walter Thurman, who played safety. I think they should try and bring him back. And then there's two offensive linemen, Molk and Tobin, who had to fill in. They weren't the greatest, but they're restricted free agents, so they'll be cheap enough. And Cedric Thornton, D-line, I think he might be a casualty just because of how much they paid Curry Cox. I think Bo Allen in his third year is ready to take the next step. You're going to be moving down Barwin and or Graham.
Yeah.
So I think he'll just eventually he'll be a casualty because he's up there in age and he'll probably be looking for $5 million a year. And at that point, you could probably allocate that somewhere else.
That'd yeah.
Probably your draft money at that point for your first rounder. But yeah, I mean, the main thing is Sam Bradford. What are you going to do with Sam Bradford? Obviously, the franchise tag's $19 million. There's talk of that. I don't know if I agree with that, but at the same time, I'd rather have the franchise tag than a long-term deal.
Yeah.
There's talk of him getting close to $25 million because there's teams out there that need quarterbacks, mainly Houston, who's ready to contend. And he'll probably be the top name out there because Kirk Cousins will be staying with Washington most likely.
Yeah.
And then he'll have Chase Daniel. So I don't know who you're going to be going with the quarterback. I think Sanchez will be cut. You might be bringing in Chase Daniel, who I love Chase Daniel. Been the biggest fan of him since Missouri, but I don't know if I'm comfortable with him being a quarterback. Obviously, he hasn't been able to do it this year, but he's been in the system.
Yeah.
And then I think you may be drafting a quarterback. I hope it's not first round. I think you got to go O-line first round. I think I looked at a couple with the Michigan State, Joe Conklin. He's projected. I mean, he's tackle guard, and I think that's what you need. I mean, you got literally no guards, and assuming Peters gets cut, you have one tackle.
Yeah.
So I think that's the best bet, offensive line. We've seen with the Broncos, you don't need a quarterback to be successful. Obviously, I'm not saying our defense is the Broncos, but I'm saying as long as you have a guy like an Alex Smith, because I'm going to compare Kansas City and the Eagles because we have Doug Peterson, I think you can try and make it work. And if you draft a quarterback in the third, fourth round, you can try and develop him. If Osweiler doesn't resign, you maybe look at him. If they decide A.J. McCarron maybe get leaving, you might look at something like that. But, yeah, I think for now, I don't think you should go crazy on Sam Bradford. I think you should figure out fill your needs, and if you have 19 mil, I think franchise tag may be an option, but I don't think you should franchise tag him and have it hamstring other areas.
Yeah, I agree with you. I don't think there's any way the Eagles franchise tag him at any point. It just doesn't make sense. I mean, that's just 19 mil for what? I mean, granted, he can get that up on the open market easily, just because how often does a quarterback with starting experience hit the market?
With still some upside, which I don't understand that at all.
I don't understand how anybody sees upside at him anymore.
I don't know how people see upside when, like, he's been in the league for 8 years.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's pretty much what we see is what we're getting now from Bradford. I don't know. I think I agree with you. I mean, I think Chase Daniel, I think if they decide to go this route, maybe they keep Sanchez just to compete for the job in camp. I think ideally, if I'm the Eagles, I, like you said, spend third, fourth, fifth round pick and sit them, just like the Jets did with Petty this year.
If the Jets are going up Petty, though, I might have to call them.
I don't think he's going anywhere. Supposedly he's improved a lot, but I think if the Eagles can bring in Chase Daniel, keep Sanchez around, spend a third, fourth, fifth round pick, maybe on a Dak Prescott.
Oh God, he's my favorite quarterback.
Vernon Adams, something that you can get late and just sit on it for a year. And like I said, have Chase Daniel, have Sanchez. I mean, I'll say it just because the rumors are out there. Foles.
Yeah. I don't
have the three of them come in. There's two jobs. One gets cut. I mean, I think that's the Eagles' best route at this point, is just play the hot hand between two experienced quarterbacks. I mean, not that any of them have had success starting, because Foles got benched for Case Keenum, so the Raiders game is gone, in my opinion.
Oh, yeah. But I mean, I think they could cut Sanchez and bring in two veteran guys in free agency for what Sanchez is getting paid.
Yeah.
And then draft a guy, so I still think Sanchez should get cut. I'm not a fan of Sanchez, obviously.
Clearly.
Other Nick Foles rumors, I don't see them. I don't see anything to it, unless we get our second-round pick back.
Yeah.
Feel like I'll take Foles back, but we'll have time to talk about that, obviously. That rumor's not going away because there's still a Foles cult in Philadelphia.
Yeah.
We got the one trade idea.
I think Rich leads it.
Yeah, we got one trade idea in for the NFL. Got my friend Zach Garber, who I've lived with down the shore for 3 years. He said, trade in Doug Peterson for Jeremiah the Axeman Trotter. And listen, I can't agree with him more. Jeremiah Trotter, one of the best little linebackers. That's one guy that I think should come back and coach.
Yeah.
He was a very good middle linebacker, knew how to read an offense, kind of the opposite of what we were talking about with Peyton Manning. But, that'll take us out of the first hour. We'll be heading into the second hour, and mainly just trade deadline.
Yeah.
Nothing more. It's very exciting. And if we get to it, we'll talk about some MLB. Obviously, pitchers and catchers are reporting at the end of the week, and we still are going through. We have two more divisions to go, as we've kind of done that sparingly. But trade deadline, mainly, possibly the Sixers making a move. A big-time move. Maybe it's the end of the rebuild. We will see. And the Knicks just trying to get stuff with very little assets. So we'll be right back on Monday Night Lights, 101.7 WDSR.
When life leaves you high and dry, I'll be at your door tonight. If you need help, if you need help, I'll shut down the city lights. I'll lie, cheat, I'll beg and bribe to make you well, to make you well. When enemies are at your door, I'll carry you away from war. If you need help, if you need help, your hope dangling by a string, I'll share in your suffering to make you well, to make you well. Give me reasons to believe that you would do the same for me, and I would do it for you,
for you. Baby, I'm not moving on, I'll love you long after you're gone.
For you,
for you.
And long after you're gone, gone, gone. When you fall like a statue, I'm gonna be there to catch you, put you on your feet, you on your feet. And if your well is empty, not a thing will prevent me. Tell me what you need, what do you need? I surrender honestly. You've always done the same for me, so I will do it for you,
for you. Baby, I'm not moving on, I'll love you long after you're gone.
For you,
for you. You will never sleep alone, I'll love you long after you're gone.
And long after you're gone, gone, gone. You're my backbone, you're my cornerstone. You're my crutch when my legs stop moving. You're my head start, you're my rugged heart. You're the pulse that I've always needed. Like a drum, baby, don't stop beating. Like a drum, baby, don't stop beating. Like a drum, baby, don't stop beating. Like a drum, my heart never stops beating.
For you,
for you. Baby, I'm not moving on, I'll love you long after you're gone.
For you,
for you. You will never sleep alone, I'll love you long after you go.
For you,
for you.
Baby, I'm not moving on, I'll love you long after you're gone.
You
will never sleep alone, I love you long,
long after you go. Like a drum, baby, don't stop beating. Like a drum, baby, don't stop beating. Like a drum, baby, don't stop beating. Like a drum, my heart never stops beating for you.
And long after you're gone, 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 I'll love you long after you're gone, gone, gone.
We're back, Monday Night Lights, 101.7 WDSR. Again, we keep running into problems with live shows. Lewis had to, I think, take a leak, so he's not here right now. When he gets back, we'll get his opinion on things. But we'll go right into the trade deadline, and we picked the song for a reason. Gone, Gone, Gone by Phillip Phillips. It sounds terrible, but we were like, while David Bowie kind of died at a terrible time because we couldn't use changes because of, we just played it on the show. I guess it was not even a month ago. So, we had to find one, and the only one we could come up with was Phillip Phillips. So I guess if you guys like American Idol, you're digging that. I'll just kind of throw out some possible trades, and then when Lewis gets back, we'll talk about them, and we'll talk about All-Star Weekend. There was a lot of talk about Dwight Howard. It seems like no matter where he goes, he is not happy. Obviously, with Orlando, he wanted out. Went to the Lakers, and for some reason, they thought him and Kobe were going to work together. It didn't. Then he ended up moving on to Houston, where it worked for a little. Now this year, they're either one game over or one game under 500, and It seems like wherever he goes, he just can't win. I don't know if it's him wanting to be the best player or him feeling that he is the best player on the team. I don't know, but there's talk about... I saw one Dwight Howard coming to the Sixers. I don't believe that for a second. There was talk about Dwight Howard going to the Celtics, possibly coming back home to his Atlanta Hawks. So, I mean, obviously a lot of rumors for Dwight Howard. He's got $22 million on him, and he is going to be a free agent after this year. So it's interesting to see where he goes as Lewis just joins us. I'm sure he picked up on the talk. I was just going over some of the trade possibilities and who's out there.
Okay.
Dwight Howard, obviously, talking about some destinations. And now I'll just ask you, because you're right back into it, where do you see Dwight Howard landing? If any place.
It's tough. I mean, rarely do the big guys get dealt at the deadline. I mean, the last one I can really think of is when we got Carmelo.
And you're still giving picks away.
Don't remind me. I mean, can I see it? Absolutely. I mean, Houston struggled. He's in his contract year. He's shown to not have loyalty to any one team, so I can see them just trying to get whatever they can for it and realizing we can't beat even the Thunder. I mean, let alone the Spurs and Warriors. So, I can see them trying to get whatever they can for him and dealing him. But as far as the team, I can see, I mean, I've seen Boston, but I can't really... I don't think he's worth that Nets pick, and I think that's what they'd have to give up to get him. You know, then again, I mean, the one trade you tweeted today, or retweeted, with the whole you guys getting the Nets pick, and that would be interesting, because then they would get the Rockets would get Jaleel, and you guys get a lot of cap room, and then the pick, and, I'm looking at it as... It's not where, if I had to pick a couple teams, I would say either Boston as a long shot, because I don't think they're ready to compete with the Cavs yet. You know, if Dwight was locked up for 3 years and the Rockets were like, we don't like him, we want to get rid of him, then yeah, I could see Boston giving up that pick and saying, yeah, no problem, we'll do it. But he's not worth that to begin with at this point, and you only get him for a year, and if he doesn't like it, he's leaving.
But at the same time, like, you have to make the move, right? Because you're not going to beat the Cavs doing nothing.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't have Kelly Olynyk as your big man.
No.
So, I mean, and they're overachieving big time. They have one of the best coaches in the league.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I would say he's top five, Brad Stevens.
Oh, yeah.
He's taking a bunch of seventh men and making them into a winning team.
Yeah, yeah.
So, I mean, is Dwight Howard the answer? Maybe it's good that you only have him for half a year. He can't ruin your team chemistry by then.
Yeah, I mean, but the problem is that they've stockpiled so many young players that teams could value. I mean, you get a couple of them back, and it starts to look a lot like the Carmelo situation. When we traded, you know, Danilo Gallinari, Ray Felton... Wilson Chandler, who's now developed somewhat nicely, Timofey Mozgov. I mean, we traded all these young pieces to Denver to get Carmelo along with picks for the next 5 years at that point. The problem is that if Boston's going to acquire him, it's going to take that Nets pick, and it would probably take... I would say Kelly Olynyk. Do you really want to give up, you know, not that Kelly Olynyk is a, you know, a long-term piece for them, but the fact of the matter is that you can use Kelly Olynyk and that Nets pick, which is huge. That could end up being Simmons in a deal to get a guy for a half season when you can, say, throw in a Sullinger, R.J. Hunter, James Young, and maybe Sacramento. I mean, with Boogie and him, I mean, everybody knows, who knows what's going on in Sacramento, but there seems to be trade rumors around him every 6 months. What's to say that one time, say, Sacramento should say, okay, we're done. You know, you're getting traded. We're done dealing with your with your garbage. You know, the young assets that they've kind of stockpiled, along with the multitude of first-round picks, the Jeff Green trade, the Rondo trade, the Garnett Pierce trade, which they'll have picks for the next 4 years. I don't see it being worth it right now to get Dwight Howard. If you were getting Orlando Dwight Howard, yeah.
But when Dwight Howard wants to play, he is a top five center.
Yeah.
Like, he could be a 20-20 guy. You saw him in the postseason last year when they had that comeback on the Clippers.
Yeah.
I mean, he looked like a franchise guy.
Yeah.
A guy you build a team around. So maybe if you're saying, maybe it's different with Brad Stevens, maybe it's different because it's only a half a year, he would be the guy on that team. He wouldn't be overshadowed by a James Harden. Wouldn't be overshadowed by a Kobe Bryant.
No.
Wouldn't be overshadowed by Van Gundy like he was in Orlando.
Yeah.
Do you think that plays a role? Do you think that will change his mind? And at the same time, you're saying you shouldn't give up the Brooklyn pick because they have other picks that they could package, but why not give up the Brooklyn pick because you have so many other picks? Because think about it. If you're sitting here now and they said, all right, you're going to have to give up the number two projected pick and Gallinari for Carmelo.
Yeah.
And you get him for definitely the rest of the year. You may be able to re-sign him.
Yeah.
Would you do that instead of giving five players up and five picks?
I mean, yeah.
I mean, it's
yeah.
It seems like a lot, but at the same time, it's if they keep
in the short term, it's a lot. In the long term, I see what you're saying.
Because if you get Dwight Howard,
yeah,
who's boxing him out on the Cleveland Cavaliers?
No one.
Exactly. And Kyrie can't stay healthy. They really haven't shown. They're shopping Shumpert right now.
Yeah.
Kevin Love's been an abomination there. He's on the trade block. So what's to say that getting Dwight Howard doesn't make you the best team in the East?
I mean, it's interesting. I mean, what do they sit at right now? They look at the standings.
They're not far behind. They're up there. I think they're top five in the conference, maybe?
Let me see here.
They're third right now.
So they're third right now behind what, Cleveland and Toronto?
Yes. And they're only 7.5 behind Cleveland and 4.5 by Toronto. And they're doing that with Isaiah Thomas, Solinger, Olynyk, Avery Bradley,
yeah,
Evan Turner.
I mean, I guess it could. I mean, Dwight Howard is going to help over Olynyk. But, I mean, I guess the problem I'm seeing is that, you know, and you made the comparison to the Melo trade when the Knicks gave up so many picks, so many players to land him. Melo was in the prime of his career, and the Knicks were trying to do something to match up to the Heat, because they had Stoudemire, they had Carmelo, and they were going to try to land Chris Paul. Didn't get him, end up getting Tyson Chandler. Didn't work, and we see the remnants of it now. But I mean, the Knicks gave up those picks, and I want to say it was 2010 when that trade was done. But, I mean, it was in that draft. I mean,
yeah, but you look at Boston, what's their number one need? A dominant big man. What wouldn't you get with that Brooklyn pick in the draft? You would not get a dominant big man.
Yeah, no. No. But, I mean, I think you're looking at a spot where, I mean, you've like I said, you've drafted well, you've gotten these guys, especially like Solinger and Olynyk, later in the draft, you know, late lottery, early playoff teams have gotten lucky to get them and have them be good. You know, have them not go along the trend of other mid-round picks. Marcus Morris. I mean, that's just one that sticks out in my head. You know, if you can add, potentially, now obviously, you know, I'm not even sure where the Nets stand right now. They're only a couple games better than you guys. And you guys always get the third pick, so. But, I mean, it's, I'm looking at a spot where Simmons could potentially be a once in, you know, him, Wiggins, and Parker could run this league in, you know, 6 years, 7 years, throw Steph Curry into it. They could be running the league and be the new Wade, LeBron, Melo. That's the problem I see, is that you're getting a big man, which, yes, you need a big man, and it seems like they're that big man away from contending, especially when, you know, you can slap Smart on either Lowry or DeRozan, and he locks him down. You know, they play good defense in Boston. They have since Doc, and it's continued. You know, you get Dwight, if he plays well, yeah, it matches up to Valenciunas. Yeah, Cleveland has no one that can match up to him. Is a matchup issue for one season really worth giving up the potential to have a Ben Simmons?
If you get Ben Simmons, you have the same problem you have now. You just add another power forward to Amir Johnson, to Kelly Olynyk, to Jarrett Solinger, to David Lee, who didn't work out.
Yeah.
So, I mean...
Well, his contract's up. So, I mean, then you're looking at his power. Okay, if you can land Simmons, similar to the Sixers, where they're looking at, you know, if they can get Simmons, move Nerlens, move Jaleel, you know, build around Simmons and Embiid, something along those lines, you're looking at the same situation. Because then you have, you know, let's just say Simmons, and then you can look, maybe Solinger, Olynyk, you know, people know that the Nets are going to be garbage. They can't bring in any free agents because anybody that wants to come to New York would rather play for the Knicks because they've been in New York for you know, 80 years, 70 years. You know, they're the New York team. Brooklyn just got there. So I think teams around the league know that the Nets are going to be garbage. They can't draw anybody in to improve that. Mostly because they're paying Joe Johnson and Brook Lopez. You know, those picks down the line they have, you know, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years from now from the Nets, have, you know, yeah, granted you don't know who the freshmen are going to be that are going to come out. But some team's going to be willing to take a chance on, let's get one of these Nets picks. You know, and then you're looking at a situation where, you know, the Kings, like I said, if you can have Simmons, Cousins, Isaiah Thomas, Smart, then it's looking a whole lot better, and you didn't give up, and you have Simmons.
Yeah, I mean, I just feel like the East is wide open right now, and I feel like a big man is the answer for the Boston Celtics, and especially because, I mean, yeah, there's other big men out there. You said Brook Lopez. You could go for Al Horford. Greg Monroe doesn't seem like he could be on the move.
Yeah.
They said he isn't available. So, I mean, like, you got a plethora of picks. I mean, you see what Dwight can be. I mean, you got a coach that is getting the best out of his players.
Yeah.
I mean, Isaiah Thomas has made an all-star team when he was a second-round pick.
Yeah.
I mean, Brad Stevens has just done a great job. Evan Turner might be the sixth man of the year.
Yeah.
So, I mean, is Brad Stevens the answer to Dwight Howard's career? Is it worth the try for a possible top four, but probably most likely a top four pick?
Yeah.
I mean, I say yes because I think they can. I think if you get Dwight Howard, you beat Toronto. Yeah, I think you beat the Cavs. I think you really do. Obviously, the Warriors are still going to be tough, but
yeah.
I mean, you can't just be like, oh, we're not making the move because of the Warriors.
No. I mean, I think what it comes back to is that if they can pull it off for, say, the Memphis and Mavs pick, you know, like if they can match up two of the picks that they have that aren't the Nets pick, then I would consider doing it, because then, you know, you're offering two first rounders to a team. I mean, that's, you know, if they're trying to just get young talent to build around Harden, that's something to look into. I mean, I don't think he's worth that, you know, potential number one pick anymore. Especially, yeah. You have no guarantee that he's going to be motivated.
I mean, much better off than the Rockets' number one player, but I see your point. So, you want to talk the Hawks or the Bucks? Because both teams seem to not want to contend and trade away their good players. I mean, Bucks, obviously, they're out of it, but the Hawks are sitting at number four in the...
Yeah. Who do you want to go with? It's up to you. I'll shoot back to you.
All right. Well, let's go with the Bucks, because they seem most likely, because they're out of it.
Okay.
And I know there's some Nets implications as well. They're what, 18 wins this year. Maybe they hit 20.
22.
Yeah.
They're 22.
They're just not good this year. Michael Carter Williams. We got a steal for him because, like I've been saying,
because that could end up being Benson.
Yeah. And it's just not. He's not a good player.
Yeah.
And then you see Greg Monroe, the big signee, and they look like they're going to move him. Chris Middleton's probably safe.
Yeah.
But they got a plethora of guys that they might move. Who do you see them moving, and where? I know there's one option you were talking over the break with me, and I laughed at you because it involved Michael Carter Williams.
Well, I was reading up today. Basically, it was an article... Again, heavily influenced with the Knicks, but it was with the Bucks, I should say. But it was how the Knicks can make the team better now and improve into the next several years without having that first round pick this year. And under the assumption that if you're making the team better, the 2018 pick that we have is not, you know, we don't want it to be good. We want it to be a playoff pick. Essentially, it was, just for the sake of describing it, I'll start with this. Trade Aaron Aflalo to the Kings because they want to do anything to make the playoffs. Even though they're trading Rudy Gay, so, or have been listening to Rudy Gay offers, so who knows how much truth there is to that. But trade Aaron Aflalo to the Kings, get Ben McLemore. He may already be a better player than Aaron Aflalo is right now, and he has upside because he's younger. So you start there. Now you've got a two-guard. So you've got McLemore, Melo, Zingod in the middle. Then you go call the Bucks. And you're looking at a situation where the Bucks may be looking for a veteran point guard to help install the offense and get everybody back up to speed. Because not that I watch a lot of Bucks basketball, but Jabari Parker looks lost. And I think that part of that might be missing most of last season with the ACL tear. But Jabari Parker looks lost. The thought is that if they can get a veteran point guard in to just ease everybody into the system, let them know how it's supposed to be played, you know, and have that veteran point guard that could kind of be kid on the court, Jose Calderon. Then you look at a spot where you are packaging up Jose Calderon, as I like to call him, Sideshow Bob Robin Lopez, and one of the two young point guards, either Grant or Galloway. Trade the three of them to Milwaukee to get Carter Williams and Monroe. And essentially, the Bucks look at it as, we got the veteran point guard to install the offense, the young guy to build around to, with our young core, with Parker, Giannis, Chris Middleton. So we get the young point guard, we got the veteran point guard to set everything up, and just someone to play center. The contracts relatively match up, because we were going for Greg Monroe, and then kind of gave just a similar offer to Robin Lopez, because he went... Greg Monroe went to Milwaukee. So the contracts match up, with the exception of Calderon being paid more than Carter Williams, obviously. But then essentially, from a Knicks standpoint, then you got a young backcourt to build around. Because essentially, you can try to mold them in the triangle, essentially. So you get the young backcourt, you still have Carmelo, you still have Porzingis, and then you get a 25-year-old 7-footer in Monroe, and have, you know, aside from Melo, now a young core that you can build around for the next, you know, 7-8 years.
I don't think that would ever happen in a million years. I was sitting back and waiting to tell you that. I just don't think that's enough for the Bucks standpoint. I think they could cash out way higher on Monroe, mainly because with the cap going up, his $15 million for the next 3 years looks phenomenal.
Yeah.
That's going to be a steal.
Yeah.
I mean, Ricky Rubio's deal, he's terrible. He can't shoot, he can't defend. And his $12 million deal is eventually going to be a steal.
Yeah.
So I think with the cap going up, I don't think that's enough. I think that's where the not having the picks hurt you.
Yeah.
I think right now, if any team's going to make a big-time deal, I think Boston's a team that can do it.
Yeah.
And I think the four guys you got to look at Boston possibly acquiring here, Dwight Howard, Greg Monroe, Brooks Lopez, and then Al Horford.
Yeah.
But I think they need to. Obviously, I think they need to. But Danny Ainge, he's been very methodical in this rebuild.
Yeah.
And the team has looked good, so I'm not sure what he's going to do. But I think it's time for them to make a move. There was talk about the Hawks moving some pieces. I don't think it's smart for them to move at all. I mean, I know they have the Spurs mentality and, like, oh, we're going to get, like, not bring in old players. We're going to bring in the young guys when they're ready, have a core. But I don't know. I think they're the fourth best team in the East, and they've been injured a lot this year. Obviously losing Carroll hurt, but I don't think you're going to be able to bring anyone in trading Horford or even Teague. I don't see them bringing them in and doing that. Being able to bring in like a guy like Carroll, I think it would just hurt them way more than they think. From a Sixers standpoint, I think they'll be the third team in every deal. There's talk about Jeff Teague. If anything, I'm going to get Dennis Schroeder. I mean, I know they're probably trying to get rid of Teague for Schroeder, but, I mean, if I'm going to pick one of them,
yeah,
I'm not giving up a bunch for Teague when I would rather give up more for Schroeder because he's much younger. The Magic, I think, might be a dark horse to make a move. They have played very well this year. They may look for that number one scoring option.
Yeah.
And if they need to clear cap to bring on a guy, maybe it's like a Rudy Gay. Hazonia, I wouldn't mind him on my team. I saw the three-team deal with, like you said, I retweeted it. It could be found on my Twitter, obviously. But one of the Liberty Ballers writers, Jake Pavorsky, tweeted out a three-team trade. It was with the Celtics, Sixers, and the Rockets. Obviously, it revolved around Dwight Howard going to the Celtics, along with KJ McDaniels. Rockets ended up getting Bradley, Carl Landry, and Jahlil Okafor. They also got the Dallas pick from Boston and the OKC pick. And then the 76ers got David Lee, an expiring contract.
Yeah.
Just because, I mean, it would offset the money. Terrence Jones, a power forward, and Sam Decker, as well as the Brooklyn pick. Now, I think the picks mess it up a little. I don't think we'll be able to get the Brooklyn pick. Just because it's just Okafor for the Brooklyn pick to take on some salary, because Boston gives up Bradley. I don't know. I think they would need a little bit more for Boston's way to accept it.
Yeah.
Bradley's played a big role for them. I think that if they kept Bradley and threw in the Brooklyn pick to the Rockets, and the Rockets, and then we got the Dallas pick, and maybe a Rockets pick, I think that would kind of work. But, yeah, it's going to be exciting. I don't think the Sixers will make any big moves. Lewis has got some high hopes for the Knicks.
I do, yeah.
We will see in
mostly bring back Derek Fisher.
Yeah, this dude's in love with Derek Fisher. He's in love with Derek Fisher more than I'm in love with Chip Kelly, I think. But
might be.
We'll take a break. We'll come back. We'll talk trade deadline. And one of the best NHL players of all time has turned 44 today. so we'll tell you who. I'm sure if you watch anything sports related, you probably already know. We're going to leave it with some Elton John, and we're going to be heading into the last half hour, last 90 feet, the, what's a hockey term? I guess the last period.
Yeah.
This is our second intermission. We'll be right back. Monday Night Lights, 101.7 WDSR.
Your blood like winter freezes just like ice. And there's a cold and lonely light that shines from you. You'll wind up like the wreck you hide behind that mask you use. And did you think this fool could never win? Well, look at me, I'm coming back again. I got a taste of love in a simple way. And if you need to know while I'm still standing, you just fade away. Don't you know I'm still standing better than I ever did? Looking like a true survivor, feeling like a little kid. And I'm still standing after all this time, picking up the pieces of my life without you on my mind. I'm still standing. Never could have hoped to win. You're starting down the road, leaving me again. The threats you made were meant to cut me down. And if my love was just a circus, you'd be a clown by now. No, I'm still standing better than I ever did. Looking like a true survivor, feeling like a little kid. I'm still standing after all this time, picking up the pieces of my life without you on my mind. I'm still standing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm still standing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Monday Night Lights, 101.7 WDSR, last half hour. I know you guys are missing us. I just said to Lewis, it feels like a really fast show.
Yeah.
I'm not really sure why. I think we get callers, and I said that to Lewis. It seems like it goes much, much slower. I don't know. I guess we're just in the groove. It's like a runner's high. You eventually get to a certain point where you just are in the groove. You don't even realize how far you're running. I need to get in that because my team Run for Beer, which consists of Jess, my girlfriend's sister, her sister's boyfriend, her father, her uncle, and someone else. I might be missing people. I don't know. But it's a 10-mile race, Broad Street Run. It's going to be something. So I'm going to try and look as ridiculous as I can for the race, because if I die during 10 miles in May, I want people to remember me. So send in what you want. Maybe get some leg warmers in there. Lewis is looking up some jerseys for me to wear. He said Ish Smith. He just bought himself the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air Will Smith jersey. Yeah. So, I don't know. We're going to see what I can find and try and look as ridiculous as I can, because I'm 10 miles is a long way. So, we'll see. But let's get on some NHL talk. We obviously got the trade deadline coming up. And Jaromír Jágr, 44 years of age. He's only the 9th player to play at age 44 or older. He is the fifth non-goalie to play at 44 or older. And if he scores, he'll be the 3rd player to score at age 44 or over. So pretty phenomenal, because when he came back in the league with the Flyers, you thought, probably only a year or two.
Yeah.
He just wanted to come back. Like, it was kind of his farewell tour. Because he's... Is he Russian? Is he Czech?
I think he's Czech.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
I would like him better if he was Czech instead of Russian. But hopefully Putin's not listening. But anyway. Yeah, I mean... We thought
the video will get banned in Russia.
Yeah, that's okay. I mean, I don't think we have any Russian fans anyway. But, yeah, I mean, we thought it was going to be his farewell tour, and then after he goes to Philly, he went to Boston, or New Jersey, Boston. Did he play for Boston? Am I making that up?
No, I think Philly, Boston, Jersey, if I remember correctly.
And then it was, then he got traded to the,
to Florida,
yeah, the Florida Panthers. So let me just fact check myself. So we got.
Oh, you might be disappointed you didn't do this ahead of time.
Yeah, I don't. See, live shows. I was talking when you were taking care of business. I was losing it back because it's a live show when we're not used to it. When the podcast, those could just be like, "Yo, pause it real quick," and I'd be like, "Yeah, sure." But now, this live shows are throwing us off. We're just YouTubers. We're YouTube famous at this point.
Oh yeah.
But he went Philly, Dallas, Boston, Jersey.
Dallas was in there.
Yeah,
I forgot Dallas.
Because he signed with, and then he got traded to Boston. And then he went Jersey, played a full year, then went half season with Jersey, half season with Florida, and now he's in a full year with Florida. So, yeah, I mean, pretty crazy that he's able to play this long, but when you have such great skill as he does, you're able to handle the puck like he does. You don't need speed or really strength at that point to keep the puck away from people. You could just use a stick handling.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's the main reason why I think he's been able to stick around. He's one of the best, if not... probably won't even say that. That's one of the sayings that I use a lot, but can't use it here because obviously Wayne Gretzky. But still, I mean, in this modern era, I think Jágr might be the best.
Yeah.
Especially for this long. I mean, 90s to 2010s, and he missed, what, 6-5 years there?
Yeah.
So, but obviously congratulations to him. I wish he could have stayed in Philly. He was awesome here. We were actually good when he was here. But let's get to talking some NHL and some trades. Obviously, it's pretty obvious, just like kind of like the way basketball is. New York's going to be a buyer, and Philly's going to be a seller. And we got one tweet in from Joe, and he said that the Rangers got to trade Staal and Rick Nash when they're healthy, and Mikkel Rath has to keep playing, even though he got clocked by Wayne Simmonds.
You just want to keep bringing that up, don't you?
That was an awesome... That punch, I replayed that about 30 times. I showed Jesse...
Did you also replay the 3 goals we scored?
No, I didn't do that, because it's a rebuilding year. But it's all about that punch. Mikkel Rath probably is rebuilding his jaw after that
punch.
Yeah. But yeah, I was so excited. I was at Jess's house for her birthday and Valentine's Day, and her mom was there, and I even showed her mom the punch, because I was just so excited. I was like, yo, you gotta check
you
this
gotta
out.
See this.
Watch this dude get dropped. But but yeah, I think I agree with him here for the most part. I mean, Staal and Nash, I think that might be an off-season move, because they're still very good players, but, I mean, eventually, you probably are going to have to move on from them. And McElrath is playing really well.
Yeah.
I mean, I give him a lot of crap for the punch, but he's playing really well, and at this point, the Rangers are up there. I mean, they're obviously 14 points behind Washington, but Washington's on a phenomenal pace. The Islanders are... I've played one less game than them, but 4 points behind, so they're there. They got the 2 seed, it seems like, in the Metropolitan. The Islanders can catch them. New Jersey realistically can catch them. Pittsburgh can realistically catch them, but, I mean, it seems like they got a 2 seed locked up.
Yeah.
And I don't see, like we looked at some of the guys last week, I mean, you had Eric Staal. You had, who else was we looking at? Drouin, but, I mean, there's a lot of guys that it would just be like, it would almost be, kind of like how, it was with Mello and the Knicks. You're going to be using a lot of picks.
Yeah.
And eventually when, I mean, for Druin, it would kind of be worth it because he's still so young, but I mean, Andrew Ladd comes to mind. I'm kind of like almost a rental at this point because I don't know. I just can't see them adding something, a player to their core when they don't have much to trade.
Yeah.
To get a young guy like Druin into their core.
Yeah, no, no.
I probably would say, I mean, I think Stahl's way too much of a cap hit, but I think
yeah.
Ladd, Hudler, and maybe Louis Erickson are probably your three guys that you have to look at. They're all around 4.5 cap hit. I think they're all in the last year of their contract, and they could give you the most. I want to put Patrick Marleau in there, but that's 6.6 mil.
Yeah.
I don't think they could make that work. It would have to move probably a big piece because they've been very good with their money. I mean, look at the big guys that are getting money spent on them. Nash, Henrik,
Girardi. Nash, McDonough, Girardi.
Yeah. And they're all part of the core.
Yeah.
So I don't see really them moving guys like that.
I don't know. I mean, I'm looking at it. Has Marleau said this is it yet?
He should. I mean,
yeah. I mean, he's 36. I mean, it could very well be it. I think the only way the Rangers land him is that if, and it would cost a decent pick, maybe a second round, third round. You know, at this point, he's probably worth a fourth or a fifth. Just with the way the picks change hands. If the Sharks eat some of the money, then that will up the value of a pick that the Rangers would give back.
Would that be the only way they could get him, though? How much cap space do they have?
I'm not sure.
They only had, like, maybe four at the most.
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure about how much they have offhand. But, I mean, that's the only way I can see it happening is that if, the round of pick that they give goes up and the amount that we owe him goes down and those Sharks eat some of it.
The Rangers have a whopping $478,000 in
nice.
Cap space.
Nice.
So, I mean, you would have to.
So a player would have to be thrown in with it, yeah.
I mean, it had to, has to be. I mean, maybe Dan Boyle at $4.5 million. I mean, he's playing well, but he's 38 and maybe able to offset because, I mean, like the tweet said from Joe, McElrath is playing really well. So, I mean, you may be able to move a defenseman, but at the same time, it's like, which defenseman are you going to move? Yandel, Klein, both younger, both cheaper. Maybe Boyle's the odd man out. Oh, excuse me. Mark Stahl, I mean, $4 million. I mean, I think that's kind of a steal. I mean, Noah hasn't played. I mean, his play went down ever since he got hit in the puck in the face against the Flyers.
Yeah.
I'm not going to take credit for that because it's a really bad injury. But, I mean, listen, he got hit in the face with a puck. I mean, I understand, but he's still worth $4 million, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
And I just don't see. I don't see them moving Nash because then where's your offense?
Yeah, where's the offense coming from?
I mean, and maybe they eat money if you give them Boyle and maybe like a second round pick because it helps offset how much money they put in and it's a good enough pick where you don't have to put in a player like a Fast, a Miller, a Hayes.
Yeah.
Well, like last year when you had to put Duclair in for Yandel.
Yeah.
So, but I mean, I think sticking even with, I think Andrew Ladd might be the best bet for you guys. I mean, he's a leader. And I'm not saying you lack leadership, but I'm saying when Martin St. Louis was there, and he's been a leader on a big time winning team, it helped out mightily. And I don't think Andrew Ladd would hurt at all. He led the Blackhawks to their first cup. He actually made Winnipeg respectable there for a while. So, and he's the cap hit's not even close to Marleau's. So I think that would probably be the best option.
Yeah. I mean, I'm looking at some of the other ones. I mean, there's not really any big names that stick out. You know, obviously Marleau, I mean, they could look for some, you know, there's some depth guys, but do you really want to give up picks for depth guys at this point?
I mean, you have some guys like Scott Hartnell, but he's getting paid more than Ladd and has a longer contract.
Yeah.
P.A. Parenteau, I mean, he's like the Sam Bradford of the NHL. Like, there's potential there. He just hasn't ever hit it.
Yeah.
I mean, Versteeg, but I feel like he's only good in Chicago.
Yeah.
I mean, so I don't know. I would say probably the best bet at the moment would probably be Ladd, and then you move down the line if the price is too high and try and fit guys in, whether it be like a Joffrey Leupel, even though he's getting paid way more. Maybe like a guy like Teddy Purcell, Cam Atkinson.
Yeah.
Just kind of just like, hey, we got a guy, and we believe around our players he can succeed. But I think you got to go the Martin St. Louis way, where you got to get a leader and just a guy who's been there before.
Yeah.
And I think Andrew Ladd's that guy. Well, I mean, he has been there before, and I think he would really help big time. I mean, yeah, you have Stefan. I mean, what's your top line? Because I'm obviously not watching many Rangers games. Stefan Nash.
Tough for me to catch him too. I want to say
Stefan Nash.
Stefan Nash Zuccarello. I'm not 100% sure. If Joe's listening, tweet it. I know he watches it a lot more than I do. So
yeah, I mean, Ladd can play. I mean, he is a center, but he can play the wing. And you have Nash, Stefan, Zuccarello, and then maybe your second line, you have, I guess they do go Brassard.
Brassard.
Kreider.
Kreider, Hayes, I think.
I mean, you might be able to go Brassard, Kreider, Ladd.
Yeah.
And, I mean, because Hayes, very young, you don't have to try and play him on the second line. Play him on the third line instead of, because it seems like a lot of young players, especially with the Flyers, it's that you give me a certain amount of good minutes, but then like if they start to creep up for more minutes, that's when they start to make the mistakes, because that's when the veterans start to figure them out.
Yeah.
I mean, that's why Kutz was so good defensively, because he would go out there, play 15 minutes a game when he was 18, and just be able to shut down the guy, but he wasn't out there long enough for them to figure him out.
Yeah.
I think Ladd would fit great on the team. I mean, Stahlberg, obviously, he's very cheap, and he's kind of come on lately. But, I mean, with this team right now, I think Tanner Glass is in your lineup.
Yeah.
Like, that's not really going to help you much, and I think a player like Ladd definitely would. I'm Team Ladd. Not Team Vlad. Team Ladd. Just to clear that up.
Just to clear that up.
I was never and never will be Team Vlad.
Not even freshman year?
Not... No, I mean, there was points where it was around, but never could get on.
Never belittled yourself to it?
I think that's why I just don't do it anymore, because I know Vlad is there.
Yeah.
If I go somewhere, I know Vlad's going to be there, and it just, like, scares me.
Yeah.
It's frightening. But let's talk about some Flyers now, because that's what the people want. People don't want that New York crap.
go ahead.
All right. So,
We got beat by Johnny Quick, not Corey Crawford.
Yeah, that's all right. But anyway, so we have the Flyers, who they have more cap space than they've had in the past 5 years combined at $3 million. So, congrats, Hextall. Well done.
Thank you, Vinny LeCavalier.
Yeah, thank you, Kings, for taking him on. But you look at some of the guys they have right now, a lot of contracts up after this year. And a guy like Mark Streit, he's getting paid $5 mil. He's 37. That probably could go to a contender.
Yeah.
He's very good on the power play. He knows what he's doing out there. Maybe he might have to eat some money like he did with Vinny, but I don't think not as much, because he's still shown that he can play. You have Nick Schultz. I mean, I think he's loved in Philadelphia. I think both by Hextall and the fans, just because, I mean, he made it on a player tryout. He was kind of like Hal Gill, but younger and more efficient. So I think the only guy that I can see really going anywhere is Streit, and then if somehow they can possibly trade Umberger, which I think would be impossible because he just scored his first goal in over a year.
Trade him for John Scott.
Yeah, I'm so open to that, but I don't even know what John Scott's getting paid. Not $4 million, and I don't think the Canadians, I don't think they want Umberger at all. Unless Hextall's blown away by a deal, like a team like the Canadians are like, we need some offense, but they don't even know if Carey Price is coming back. I heard they might try and throw a lot for Simmons out there. I would hate it, but if you're able to get a boatload back, you may have to think about it. Voracek has come on lately, so unless you're blown away, I wouldn't move him. Guys like Delzato, he's still young, but will he resign or will he try and get something big in free agency? You only got him; he's done after this year. That'd be interesting to see. Some guys like Matt Reed, you signed him that deal for $4 million. Never really panned out to what you were paying for. So at that price, I don't think a team touches them. Other than that, I think Neuvirth may be the second best option to trade because so cheap. He's played really well. Maybe a team like Montreal because they might have lost Price for the whole year.
Yeah.
But other than that, I don't really see much movement for the Flyers unless, like I said, they're blown away by a deal, which they could very well be. Look what they got for Coburn last year.
Yeah.
We'll see, obviously. But I don't see the Flyers making big moves. Sellers, obviously.
Yeah, yeah.
What teams do you think, since we got 7 minutes here, which teams do you think could be the biggest buyers, and which teams could be the biggest sellers?
I don't know. I think Montreal could be a pretty decent buyer.
It has to be, right?
Yeah.
They have the team in place. Carey Price might be out for the rest of the year.
Yeah.
But they still got a pretty good team in place. Do they go out for a goalie, but then it goes, who is that goalie?
Yeah.
What goalies are out there? I think you got Neuvirth, and I think that may be your best option.
Yeah.
Robbie Lehner has played well with Buffalo, but I don't really see like big time. You might have the guys that always move at the deadline, like Scrivens and Victor Fast, or not Victor Fast. Who was a goalie that was with Anaheim and then went to the Oilers? His name's Fast, but I don't know what his first name was.
I'm not sure.
But I don't. Maybe Eddie Lack.
Yeah.
But no guys that are going to give you Carey Price impact, so
no.
It'd be interesting. They'd probably be buying both a forward, defenseman, and goalie. So they would, if they decide to buy, they definitely have to be big buyers in my mind.
Yeah.
I think looking just how much cap room they have, the Nashville Predators, they got $10 million cap space. Like, they may be buying.
Does that have Johansson in it?
Yeah, it does.
Oh, wow, so they still have $10 million on top of that?
Johansson is still getting paid.
$4 million it's got here.
Yeah, he's very little. So, I don't see how they can't make a deal. Their highest paid player is Pecorine, it's $7 million.
Yeah.
So, I think it
has. And you look at them, and, they just acquired 23-year-old Johansson. Could they make a run at Jonathan Drouin and just, these young players, just bring them in?
Because eventually Shea Weber, they're probably going to buy him out.
Yeah.
Pecorine's...
That'll be when the Flyers finally get him.
Yeah, great. And then Pecorine's up there at 32, so Mike Fisher, 34. It's time to start bringing in a younger core, and they have the picks. They are loaded with defensemen, so I don't see why they couldn't be able to do that. Yeah, I like that, and even maybe a guy like an Andrew Ladd.
Yeah.
I don't know. It just... They seem like it makes too much sense for them to make a deal.
Yeah.
I know they already got Johansson, but, their stacked on defense, but you look at some of their forwards. I mean, you got Gallstad 33, Ribeiro 35, Fisher 34. I mean, if you bring in a lad at 30, depending on what those three centers decide to do at the end of the year, you can always re-sign Ladd.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think he would. I think he fits really well in Laviolette's system.
Yeah.
Some of the big sellers, I would probably have to say the Winnipeg Jets. I know they just re-signed Byfuglien, but I mean, they have Blake Wheeler, they have Ladd, who I've been talking about. People think I'm in love with Ladd. But I mean, if they decide to move Pavlec, maybe that could, Montreal could look there. I mean, they got some pretty good pieces. They look like they're ready for a complete rebuild at this point. Drew Stafford, Little. So, Tyler Myers, who has been in the league for like 7 years. He's like the younger version of Sam Bradford, a potential eventually. Some reason he's getting paid like $7 million. I think it's 5.5 actually. But, yeah, I see them just moving on. I think the Florida Panthers should look to buy.
Yeah.
I think they are still very, very underrated. Very, very young. Obviously, if you look at their average age, it's kind of evened out by Jaromír Jágr.
Yeah.
He's like double some of the kids' ages.
Yeah.
You look at Jonathan Huberto, he's 21. Then you got Jágr, who's 44. But, I mean, I think maybe a defenseman, just because I feel like you got Ekblad. I think you might be able to add an older player. Pretty good defenseman out there. And if you're going to make a run, you could go for a big, big splash with Eric Staal.
Yeah.
I mean, they have the picks. They have the young players. But then you could also go a Marleau. You could go
a Hartnell.
Yeah, someone that kind of just could add depth with them. Because, I mean, look at some of their wingers. I mean, you have Huberto, but you have Jágr. You have Jokinen. You have Sean Thornton. And you just kind of look and you're like, all right, well, they could probably add a wing, and they might need that big wing.
Yeah.
I mean, Jágr's a very nice player, but he's not what he used to be. He's not a top liner. And Jokinen has bounced around among teams, so I think they got Jágr and Jokinen, I think they could be third-line guys at this point just because of their age.
Yeah.
I would think you could definitely add someone like a Hartnell, Marleau, a Hudler.
Yeah.
Someone like that. I think that would be really big for them. So, obviously, I don't know when that trade deadline is. I think it's...
I believe it's the 29th.
29th. So we can still talk about the trade deadline, and I believe there'll be more rumblings, most likely, as we get closer. Let's see if there's any more on Hoops Rumors, because go to hoopsrumors.com. They'll give you all the latest trade talk. The Mavericks are not looking for a potential blockbuster for Harden or Howard. I read that and I thought I just was taken back a little. But I mean,
Mark Cuban not looking for a blockbuster? What is this?
Mark Cuban secretly looking for a blockbuster. He just realized that he can't
get a blockbuster. He's probably gonna try to trade for DeAndre Jordan.
He's like, yo, Mr. Wonderful, how about you give me the $22 million for Dwight Howard and I'll give you 43% of the Mavericks. Just Shark Tank joke, you know?
Yeah.
But, follow us on Twitter at donthassle_hoff, at Sheer500, and at OfficialMNL. All those Twitter handles will be following the trade deadline.
Yes.
We love the trade deadline. Last year, we were in Intro to Radio, me and Lewis, and it was like 5 o'clock on trade deadline day, and we're in class, and our phones are blowing up, and I'm seeing, like, Carter Williams gets traded, and I'm just turning around looking at Lewis. I'm just like, dude, are you seeing this? I think Dragic got traded.
Dragic,
Brandon Knight,
Carter Williams, KJ, Isaiah Thomas. It was
nuts. But yeah, so trade deadline.
I think I tweeted something that day. I was like, that was the craziest one since like the Knicks got Melo.
Yeah, and it was like 10 minutes long. Like it all happened at the same time. It's one of the best days of the year, I think. But follow us. We'll be given our expertise. The expertise that we have.
Yes.
So,
I will offer a bit of expertise here. Phil, please call up D-League All-Star Game MVP Jimmer Fredette before someone else does. Please.
And if you're wondering, in intramural basketball, I know we bring it up last week or 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, we brought it up.
Yeah, we talk about our teams, right?
Yeah.
How well they're doing. The playoff.
Or how not well my team's doing.
So, for tonight's, the playoffs came out, the rankings, so there's eight teams, and there's an Eastern Conference. My team finished first in the Eastern Conference. I got a single-double the other day, or no, a double-single. I got 4 points and 3 rebounds, so I was excited about that. Lewis's team is the George Mason of the Western Conference.
Yeah.
So we're going to see if he can.
I also had a double-single. I had 2 points and 5 boards.
That's where it's at. Eating glass. That's what we do on Monday Night Lights, just get boards. That's what it's all about. So we left you, or we carried you over 2 minutes, so we'll leave you. And we'll come back next week with probably trade deadline recap.
Oh, yeah.
More trade deadline talk. More NFL talk, as the franchise tags can be given out tomorrow. So that'll be very exciting. And, I was talking to Lewis today. We didn't get to NCAA basketball, but the tournament's about a month away.
Yes.
So I looked at Notre Dame's schedule today. They got up and ranked 19th now, and I was like, oh, my God, they have 5 games left. So get excited for the tourney, and we're going to get excited. We're going to be talking more NCAA, and we'll have our brackets. We'll get, actually, people to send in their brackets, and then we can maybe have a competition between Monday Night Light listeners and the Monday Night Light host. So thanks for listening to Monday Night Lights, 101.7 WDSR. Have a great week.